Praise God. Welcome all of you to our Sunday service, and we also welcome everyone who is viewing us online today. Let's begin today's service with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for this beautiful day, Father God. Thank you, Lord, for every person who's come into your house, Lord Jesus. Father God, may every person be enriched today, Father God. May they be nourished by your word, Lord. May your word give them strength and power, Lord Jesus. May your word bring healing in our midst today, Father God. Thank you, Lord, even as we glorify and exalt your name today, Father God. And as we exalt your word, Lord, we thank you. Your word says signs and wonders will follow the word of God, Lord. Lord, we thank you that there will be healing today, Lord. There will be deliverance today, Lord. There will be financial breakthroughs today, Father God. Father God, we commit the worship team into your hands, Father God. Use them mightily to glorify your name today, Lord. And we commit the entire service and everyone who's on their way, Lord. May they come quickly and safely in Jesus' name, Father God. We commit the entire service from start to finish into thy loving hands, Father God. In Jesus' name we pray. Welcome, Brother Thiru and Brother David, to lead us in a time of worship.
Pastor, praise the Lord, everyone. Nice to be in the house of the Lord, and let's worship the Lord. Bible says, greater is he that is in me than he is in the world. As we're going to sing this, this is one of my favorite songs. Let's sing and worship the Lord. More love,
let's sing it again. I will worship. And I will worship you with all of my heart. And I will worship you with all of my mind. And I will worship you with all of my strength. For you are my Lord. You are my Lord. For you are my Lord.
You are my Lord. For you are my Lord. You are my Lord, for you are my Lord. You are my Lord.
Jesus, you are my God. You are everything, God. Jesus. You are everything in our lives, God. You have chosen us, O God. We are your children, O God, Jesus. You love us so much, O God, Jesus. As your heaven is a throne and earth is your footstool, Lord Jesus. You are such a big God, Jesus. You love us so much, O God. You have chosen us when we are in the mother's womb, O God, Jesus. We are so blessed, O Lord Jesus. We are so blessed, O Lord Jesus. We thank you every day in our lives, O God. Every moment in our lives, O God, Jesus. Lord, be with us, O God, Jesus. Hold our hands, O God, Jesus. Lead us, O God, Jesus. Mold us, O Lord Jesus. Encourage us, O Lord Jesus. Guide us, O Lord Jesus. Strengthen us, O Lord Jesus. Lord, bless us, O Lord. Give us peace, your grace and understanding, O Lord Jesus. To stand firm in your presence, O God. In this world, let us be an example in this world, O God, Jesus. Your name has to be glorified, O God. Your name alone has to be glorified, O God. Not by will, not by power, but by your Spirit, says the Lord. Lord, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for adding one more day in our lives, O God, Jesus. Thank you for blessing us, O God, Jesus. Lord, as we praise and worship you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for being with us, O God, Jesus. Lord, thank you, Jesus. Also pray for the people who are viewing online, O Lord Jesus. Bless each and every individual, O God, Jesus. Whatever might be the needs, whatever might be the thoughts, what they're going in their minds, O Lord Jesus. You fulfill their desires in their hearts, O God, Jesus. Bless them, O Lord. Bless them, O Lord Jesus. Comfort them, O Lord Jesus. Motivate them, O Lord Jesus. Also pray for the remaining portion of the service into your mighty hands, O God, Jesus, Lord. I commit the pastor into your mighty hands, O God, Jesus. You bless him, O Lord. Anoint him, O Lord. Speak through him, O Lord Jesus. Speak each and every word, but Lord, mold us, O Lord Jesus. Mold us, O Lord Jesus. Use us for your kingdom growth, O God. I commit everything into your mighty hands, O God, Jesus. Let your name alone be glorified. In Jesus' name I pray. Praise God. Welcome all of you to our Sunday service once again. Welcome everyone watching us online. And thank you so much, Brother Thiru and Brother David, for leading us in a blessed and a powerful time of worship. So let's get into God's word today. Last week we understood so clearly about how the foundation of God's word is so important. What that means basically is that anytime we have any doubt in our life, or how do we treat our enemies, what do we do when we are sick, what do we do when we are looking for success, what do we do when we are ministering to others, like Brother Anurag said, we build our foundation, we build our life on what God's word says for us. And that is a very strong foundation to build every area of our life, our marriage, our future, our destiny. And that's what we understood. So we've completed the Beatitudes, and now we are looking at Matthew's account of what he's telling us, recorded from the life of our Lord Jesus. So today is a very important message. I say that always, but today I feel is a very important message, because some of the points that we are going to touch today from Matthew chapter 8 verses 1 to 17 is going to help you. It may not help you today, but tomorrow in your day of crisis, or in your day when some challenge happens suddenly, what do you do? The first thing that we do generally is we run to our prayer group, or we run to a man of God, or we run to a prophet. But the greatest and the highest way is to directly receive from our Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus, he's equipped all of us to live this life very, very successfully, very powerfully, not like how the world. When the world has a crisis, they don't know what to do. They run from pillar to post, not having a surety that they're going to overcome this challenge. But you and I, from God's word, I want to show you today that any challenge that comes your way, any challenge that comes towards your family member, we have a very solid and a strong foundation to stand upon. So that's what we're going to look at today. So I encourage you, even as you go back home, study this word. Because supposing a thief breaks into your house today, and if you're not strong enough, he's going to overpower you and he's going to rob everything in your house. But if you're already building your muscles, you have some tools in your house, when the thief comes, you're going to whack him and whack him properly. But when he comes, if you're going searching for that broomstick or that stick or whatever you're searching for, he's going to come, he's going to sit, he's going to whack you and take everything. So that's why today, when we are teaching and looking at God's word, it's going to prepare us for the battle. Let me read Matthew chapter 8 verse 1. When he had come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." So now, look at the instance. Jesus is teaching on the mount. He's teaching. He just came down from the mount. And as he is coming down, this leper, you must understand that leprosy was a disease that was incurable in those days. Today, if a man has leprosy and it's identified at an early stage, it is curable. But those days, leprosy was like a form of disease which would ultimately kill the person. It'll just eat into the flesh, eat in slowly into the organs and kill the entire person. So anyone who had leprosy in those culture could not enter the synagogue. They had to maintain 150 feet of distance. And when they come into the city, they'll have to shout, "Unclean, unclean, unclean." So everyone will just move far away from that person. So imagine the stigma, the pain that a leper had to go through. And in spite of that, this leper wanted his healing. He knew that Jesus was able to heal. He said he must have thought in his mind, "Enough is enough. I am not going to put up with this disease anymore." And then he went to Jesus in spite of they could have stoned him to death if a leper comes. They could have caught him, bound him and thrown him out of the city. In spite of that, he went to Jesus. And look at his words. He says, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." So the question is, he was not worried that or concerned if Jesus could heal him. He knew, "Lord, you can make me clean." But his only doubt was, "Lord, are you willing to make me clean?" And that is the doubt that many of us have today. We may think, okay, healing is for that sister, healing is for that brother, healing is for that man of God because he spends so much time in God's word. But the doubt is, will God heal me? Will God deliver me? Will God strengthen me? That's the first doubt that comes to a person's mind. And sometimes I know, like being in the ministry for a little while, I know the challenges that people have. Supposing someone says, doctor says your kidneys are failing, or this is a terminal disease, or this is a cancer that will lead to death. This can give you 6 months, or it can be just a simple thing that you may be taking some medication, or it might be a simple headache, a sinus problem that's troubling you for a long time. So, but today we'll understand, how does Jesus look at that problem you're suffering with? What does he see? What is his will? I'll just read the next verse. Then Jesus put out his hand and touched him, saying, I am willing, be cleansed. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, see that you tell no one, but go your way. Show yourself to the priests and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. So here, very clearly, Jesus said, I am willing. So anytime you have a doubt, if it's a cold or a cough or even a terminal disease or any challenge that you're going through, the answer is Jesus is completely willing to heal that exact disease, that exact sinus, that exact skin problem, any problem that you're facing. Jesus is very, very clearly willing to heal you. So that is settled. We should not doubt if Jesus wants to heal my disease. No. Jesus clearly said he's willing. And then he said, go show yourself to the priest. In the Levitical, so then he said, go show yourself to the priest. Under the Levitical priesthood, what would happen is that after a person was healed, and this man was healed by Jesus. Jesus stretched out his hand. Look at the heart of Jesus. He immediately, when the leper asked him, are you willing to heal me? He just stretched out his hand and said, I am willing, be cleansed. And then go show yourself to the priest, so that the priest could examine and say, okay, this man is completely healed of leprosy. He can go back to the church. He can go back to the synagogue. So today it's determined and very clear that Jesus is willing to heal you and me of any disease we may be going through. Mark's gospel says, Mark chapter 16 says that, in my name you will cast out demons. In my name you will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. So many of us, we know this verse. We know that there is power in the name of Jesus. But what happens? We don't use our authority over sickness. Many times, God has given us the name of Jesus to use against sickness, to use against any challenge. But those simple things we fail to use. I'll share one or two testimonies of how Jesus healed me, how Jesus has used us to heal another person. It's his name. So what happens? We forget to use the name of Jesus. But you and I must use our authority. How do you explain authority? Let me read this verse and I'll explain authority to you. Philippians 2:10-11 says, and this is a very important verse for us as believers to memorize, because tomorrow when a challenge comes, we should not, the first thing that should happen, we should not be overwhelmed with fear. Anytime you see a mother, a father, a child, a sister or brother, or when you see yourself sick or something serious happens, at that time of crisis, what should you and I do? The first thing we should do is not panic. Because when you panic and when you are fearful, it's going to take a lot of time to again put on your faith, again encourage yourself in the Lord. So at a crisis, remember, don't panic. That's why in advance, read these chapters. Be prepared so that when that day of crisis comes, your family will panic. Your relatives may panic. But when your mind is renewed, you'll stay strong. You'll use the name of Jesus and you'll cast out those demons. You'll lay hands on the sick, they'll recover. Or you'll pray over yourself and you'll see yourself healed. Philippians 2:10-11 says that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Many a time you may pray and you may not see a demon that is cast out because you don't understand your power and authority. But in the previous verse, Mark's gospel says that I give you, Jesus has delegated every power and authority to the church. He says, go in my name, cast out demons, lay hands on the sick, and they will see you. For example, how do I give you an example? Take, sometimes husbands understand authority very, very well. We know that sometimes when a husband does something wrong, and I don't know how many of you have noticed, but I notice all these things very carefully. And one stare, just one glare from the wife, and their husband immediately will sit down. I've seen that, just one stare from the corner of her eye, husband. But if the husband is a stubborn man, and he continues doing things that the wife does, I've noticed this, one head nod and another stare. So I've noticed these things. But the husband, if he's still stubborn, I've noticed in my own house also. So I noticed after some time, what happens? A hand comes up and one stern stare. Then I know it's finished. The whole church has to pray for that husband. So like that, husbands understand authority very well. In the same way, when you know your authority, when you know how much of power is there in the name of Jesus, and when you just say, sickness, I curse you in Jesus' name, that sickness will dry up and disappear. When you say, demon of strife or division, I cast you out in Jesus' name, that demon will be cast out. Whatever it is, we have no excuse. We don't have to run. Yes, sometimes it's good to go to a man of God, go to a prophet when you really need help. But God is giving you the name of Jesus. We forget to use that name. If you just start using that name, simple. When you have a cold, begin to use that name. When you have a headache, begin to use that name. Even recently, I had terrible body pain. And I was taking dolo after dolo. I was taking so many dolos, but the body pain still remained. And this body pain was very terrible. I was not able to sleep, not do my regular work, playing with the dog. I was not able to do anything. Then I was sitting here after taking a dolo. I was sitting here on the steps. And then I was reminded the power that is there in the name of Jesus. And generally, when you take 2-3 dolos, the pain should go. But then I remembered, okay, maybe God wants me to use my authority. So I just kept my hands on my leg here while I was sitting on the steps. And I cursed. I don't know what is causing the pain. There was no fever, but terrible body pain. I just cursed the pain. And in just 2-3 minutes, the entire pain left. Till today, it's not come back. So why I am saying this is, there's so much of power. I have countless testimonies. Don't think that I'm always using my testimony, because when I share about what Jesus has done for me, you'll also realize that same Jesus can do it for you. And when you share the power of the name of Jesus with another person, that person will realize if Jesus can do it for that brother or sister, he can do for me. I remember once my mother kept on falling sick regularly. She would keep vomiting. And she took tablets, she took everything that was there for her stomach, and one day she told me to pray. But before that, many times I have prayed for her. I'll just curse it in Jesus' name, but then in 1 week's time, again she'll come back, that vomiting will come back. Then suddenly, as I was praying, I was reminded, why don't I pray and command this never to come back again? So I just laid my hand on my mom's shoulder and I just cursed the stomachache. I cursed the root of the stomachache. I said, I command you in Jesus' name to go, never to come back, lifelong home. It's been 7 years now. She's not have a single symptom of that vomiting. Why I'm encouraging you is, I want each of you, in your house, when you see sickness, when you see your daughter sick, when you see your parents sick, even when you see things in your work. Another quick testimony and I'll go forward. I remember during the recession, 2010, at that time, I lost my job because of the recession, and I was working at home, and so many things went contrary. 6 months, I kept on searching for a job. I had so many good friends who would take my resume, go and give it in companies because they were good friends and they wanted to help me. So I went company to company, so many companies, so many interviews that I did, but not one interview called me back. Then as I was listening to a message, I was reading Kenneth Hagin, how the name of Jesus can not only be used for healing, but it can be used to break bondages. You can be used to get delivered from financial curses. So as I was studying Kenneth Hagin, I just took my authority and I said, God, this is what your word says. I just kept on saying, God, that in Jesus' name, in Deuteronomy 28, you said, whatever I put my hands to will prosper. I just said, for 1 hour, I prayed that day in Jesus' name. And that same week, I got 5 offer letters. All the interviews called me. I attended so many. I had 5 offer letters that I could choose. 1 in Chennai, 2-3 in Bangalore, and another in another place. So why I'm saying this is, the name of Jesus is available to each of us, but we forget to use that name sometimes. But I encourage you, remember to use that name in whatever battle, sickness, finances, family problems, whatever it is, use the name, because Jesus said, I have given that authority to the church. Church is not this building, it's you and me. Let's continue. The next instance is Matthew chapter 8, verse 5-13. Now, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does this. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from the east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of this kingdom doesn't refer to believers. It's referring to the Jews who rejected Jesus. The sons of the kingdom will be cast out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way. And as you have believed, so let it be done for you. And his servant was healed that same hour. So the centurion, this is a very important verse, because seldom and rarely you'll find in the Bible, one translation says, Jesus was astonished. Jesus was marveled at the centurion's faith. Why was Jesus marveled at the centurion's faith? The centurion, again, he's a Gentile centurion. And for him to come to a Jew, he comes to Jesus who was a Jew and he explains his problem. What was the problem that the centurion was facing? The centurion, his servant, was sick, almost dying in the deathbed. That's what, if you read, you'll understand that the servant was just not sick, but the servant was almost dying. And that time, the centurion comes. But look at what the centurion had understood. He said, Jesus, you don't have to come to my house. I'm not worthy, because he was a Gentile. And for a Jew to go to a Gentile house was considered unworthy in those days. So he's telling Jesus, you don't have to come to my house. I'm not a worthy man that you should come so far. Just speak one word and my servant will be healed. Then he explains to Jesus that he's understood the power and the authority of Jesus' word. He said, Jesus, I know I am a soldier. I am like a military major or a colonel. I am a person of such authority. I'll tell them, do this, they will do this. I'll tell them, do that, they will do that. I'll tell them, stand up, sit down, they will do everything. They will not argue at all. They'll just do whatever I tell them. In the same way, he understood Jesus had that same spiritual authority. And the Bible says that at that very instance, the centurion's servant was healed at that very instance. So today we must not forget that the centurion recognized power that is there in God's word. Today you and I must recognize that there is power in God's word. Whatever area of life you're facing a challenge, sometimes it could be related to finances, sometimes it could be related to a sickness, sometimes it could be a family member who's suffering or struggling. Whatever that is, God has given us not only his name to use his name powerfully, but he's also given us his word. So you can take God's word. Isaiah 53 verse 4, by the stripes of Jesus I've been healed. God will move heaven and earth to show you what his plans are for you. God says, I have plans to prosper you and give you hope. God says, I'll supply all your needs according to my riches and glory. So whatever challenge you have in life, simple thing that you and I can do, take God's word. The centurion needed a healing for his servant. He just took Jesus at his word. In the same way, whatever challenge you and I are facing, just take God's word, begin to speak it in prayer, and I guarantee you that miracles will happen, things will change. The Bible says the word of God is like dynamite, it's like fire, it can break down an entire mountain. So every time you speak God's word, that mountain, that challenge will keep on changing and be completely. Sometimes so many people in our prayer group are going through court trials and they are having victory. Some of them have told us the court trial, the case has just been quashed and just been dismissed. Sometimes property matters. Use the name of Jesus. Use the word of Jesus that he'll give you success over your enemies. Your enemies will come in one direction, they'll run in seven different directions. So today, not only do we have the name of Jesus, but we also have the word of God, which is so powerful. But we should not forget to use the name and the word in prayer. Finally, Hebrews 4 verse 1 to 2 says, therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. For indeed, the gospel was preached to us as well as to them. But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. So we know hundreds of people can listen to the word. Those days, thousands followed Jesus. But did everyone receive a miracle? No. Did everyone take God's word and did they see victory in God's word? No. It's only those when they heard the word of God, they went back, they studied the word, they put it in their heart, they meditated on the word and they bore fruit. They saw that problem change. So everyone is not going to receive, but those who take the word of God seriously, who mix it with faith. Jesus said, when I come back to the earth, will I still see faith? Will I still see people? This is not a faith for salvation, but it's talking about, will I still see faith of people trusting me, believing me, trusting and relying on me? So lastly, we must remember that in some areas of our life, we'll be really strong. Supposing some of us, when it comes to praying for others, we'll pray and see victory. Some of us, if it's a sickness, we know how to receive healing from God. Some of us, if it's financial problems, we know how to receive financial miracles. But there are areas of our life that there still might be, we have not come so far. We've not progressed. We are seeing a hindrance for a very long time. It's those exact areas that you write down, you make note of, and then you begin to start speaking in Jesus' name. You begin to start confessing the word over the two things that you're meant to do as a believer. You don't have to run to a man of God. You don't have to go to a prophet. You don't even have to ask the prayer team to pray. Yes, it's good sometimes when you have a challenge, it's good to have people pray with you. But then the greatest way to receive a miracle or the greatest way to receive an answer from God is to use the name of Jesus and to speak his word in prayer. just this last verse and we'll close. Verse 14 to 17. Some scholars say that this is the reason why Peter denied the Lord Jesus three times. Verse 14 and 15. Let me just read that. Now when Jesus had come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother-in-law sick with a fever. So he touched her hand and the fever left her and she arose and served him. Some of you still didn't get the joke. I said, this is the reason why Peter denied the Lord Jesus thrice. And because Jesus raised his mother-in-law from death's bed. Okay, now the lights are burning bright. So, then verse 16 says, when evening had come, they brought many to him who were demon-possessed. And he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, he himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. So, just two important things and we'll close with prayer. When evening had come, they brought to him many who were demon-possessed, many who were sick. And Jesus, he did not say, I'll cast out this sickness, I'll heal this person, I'll heal only that person. Every single person with any sort of sickness or evil torment or demon possession, everyone Jesus healed. But ultimately, verse 17 says that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet. What was spoken by Isaiah the prophet? Isaiah the prophet said, by his stripes you have been healed. And this was Matthew chapter 8 verses 8, verses 17, 1 verse 17 is a fulfillment of a prophecy spoken by Isaiah. In Isaiah chapter 54 verse 4, this is the exact fulfillment. So, and then it says, he cast out the demons with the word. So, do you see that how a prophecy spoken centuries back came to be fulfilled? Why? Because it's the word of God that was spoken. So, the word of God has so much power and authority over your life and my life today. A prophecy being fulfilled. So, every word has power and authority. So, don't underestimate God's word today. I'm just going to spend some time in prayer. And as I pray, I just want you to remember that I'm going to pray in the name of Jesus. Don't keep your focus on me, but keep your focus on Jesus, because he's going to heal you, even if it's a small sickness or an illness, or if it's any other challenge, whatever it may be, let's trust Jesus to heal us completely today. So three things don't forget today as we close this message. One, remember to use the name of Jesus. Don't forget to use the name of Jesus. In any crisis, use his name. It has a lot of power. It says, every knee in heaven and on earth and under the earth will bow to the name of Jesus. Secondly, God has given each of us his word, and his word is lifted above his name. So there's a lot of power in God's word. Finally, if there are any areas in your life that is out of place, bring it back into subjection to God's word and to God's name. So shall we close? I'll just quickly pray for the tithe and then we'll close with a word of prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father God, for everyone who has contributed into your hands in this month of June, Father God. We pray, Lord Jesus, even those who may be giving online or who have given today, Father God, or over the month, we just pray, Jesus, that you would open the floodgates of heaven and pour out a blessing that they will not have room to contain in Jesus' name. Father God, we pray that you will curse the devourer, Lord. They'll have no unforeseen, no unnecessary expenses. Their money will be blessed and be put to a blessed use, Father God. In Jesus' name, we bless the tithe and the offering. May it multiply in the hands of your children, Father God. In Jesus' name, Father God, once again, we just remember, Lord, today that there's so much power and authority in your name, Lord Jesus. Even as we take our power and authority today, Lord Jesus, we know, Lord, that miracles are going to happen. Yes, Lord, yesterday you showed me about how you're going to walk into the church, Lord, how from the back you're going to touch people, Father God. You showed me so clearly, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, even now we take our authority. We command and curse every sickness, illness and disease. I curse you in Jesus' name. Every sickness and disease, I command you to leave God's children, God's people right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Sickness, illness, disease, even if it's a small sickness, a small illness, every sickness and disease, headaches, body aches, everything, I just curse you and command you to leave in Jesus' name. I just feel like praying for resistance power for each of us today. Father God, I just pray over each person seated here, each person online, Lord, that today you would bless them with abundant resistance power, Lord. You will bless them with abundant health and strength to do your assignment, Lord. May resistance power be increased today, Father God. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, I speak blessed resistance over each child here, Lord. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Father God, I'm reminded of people's work today, Lord. I'm reminded, Lord, where they are, Lord, and where you want them to go, Father God. I just pray, Father God, I declare, Lord, every person associated with this ministry, Father God, every person, may they see abundant success. May doors open for them quickly, Father God. The doors that you want them to be open, Father God. May doors very, very quickly be open, Father God. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, may financial miracles break forth among your people in our midst, Lord. May financial miracles happen, Father God, for those who are concerned about the finances of their parents, Lord. Father God, you're the God who supplies all of their needs and our needs, Father God. May parents be blessed, Father God. May parents be provided by you, Father God. Every property, every challenge that the families are facing, may they see victory today, Father God. In Jesus' name, Father God. Father God, we thank you for answering all our prayers today, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for speaking to each person seated here, Lord. We pray that each person will be doers of the word, Lord. They'll use your name, Lord. They'll use your word, Lord, with power and authority, Lord. Signs and wonders will break forth through your children, Lord, in their homes, Lord, in their neighborhoods, Lord, in their offices, in their families, Father God. I thank you, Lord. Signs and wonders are going to follow your word, Father God. Once again, Lord, we bless each person here, everyone watching us online. May they have a very blessed and fruitful week, Father God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each and every one of us, both now and forevermore, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you everyone for joining us today. God bless you. Thank you everyone who joined us online. God bless you and wish you all a very blessed week in Jesus' name. Amen.